everyone, and welcome. My name is Christine Kennedy, and on behalf of the Office of Alumni Engagement, I'd like to thank you for joining us today as we welcome McMaster graduate and University Chancellor Santee Smith to give a talk in advance of National Indigenous Peoples Day, which is celebrated on the summer solstice, which is happening on Wednesday this year. We encourage the McMaster community to take the time and reflect on celebrate this history, heritage, resilience, and diversity of the First Nations, Inuit, and Métis across Canada. I'm up in my house in Ancaster, which is just up the hill from McMaster. So I would like to take the opportunity to acknowledge that the land on which this webinar is taking place is the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabe nations. The territory was the subject of the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Agreement, an agreement between the Iroquois Confederacy and the Ojibwe and allied nations to peacefully share and care for the resources around the Great Lakes. At McMaster, we start our events with a land acknowledgement to show both respect to Indigenous peoples and their enduring connection with their traditional territories and its history, and is an important step in reconciliation. If you'd like to learn more about the meaning of land to Indigenous peoples or the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Agreement, we'll put some links in the chat for you to read. Today, I'm so thrilled to be introducing our guest speaker, Chancellor Santee Smith. She is so wonderful, and I'm so grateful that you will have the opportunity to just learn how great Santee is as well. Chancellor Smith, thank you for joining us, and please take it away.
Sego, Sewaguego, Santee Smith, Dagalunyakwa, Nyungnyat, Skaingehaga, Nibagohotsoren, Waginyata, Oswege, Nidwageno. Greetings, everyone. My name is Santee, and my Gayengeha, or my Onkwehónwe'néha name, is Dagalunyakwa, which means picking up the sky. And I am from Oswege. And Oswege is the way that we would say Six Nations of the Grand River. And I only recently, through my language research, came to know the meaning of Oswege. And Oswege refers to the rippling that you would see under the river, not a rapid, but you could see the undercurrent. And that's what Oswege means. And because we were situated through our Haldimand Treaty agreement along 6 miles on either side of the Grand River, that's how we became known as Six Nations Oswege. So I'm happy to be here to share with you some of my work that I do as an embodied storyteller and as a visual artist that links to my family and my ancestral history in arts and creativity, and also the current work that I'm investigating, which all has to do with land-based knowledge and really looking to natural energy and patterns and Indigenous science and horticulture as ways of designing and looking at pre-colonial mindset of how we actually aligned and understood and communicated directly with the natural living universe, of which we are a very small part. And part of my role at McMaster University, which was last week, was to be chancellor. And I'm very happy always to offer the Ohandu Galawadegwe, which is the words before all else, also known as the Thanksgiving address. And that really acknowledges and frames our understanding in our place within this intricate web of creation, human beings being a small part. And then it really frames our responsibilities to be custodians, to understand our interdependencies, that what we do to nature ripples out and actually returns to affect us as well. So ancestors had this deep understanding of relationality to land and community. And so bringing that into consciousness is really important, how we frame things. So I won't say it right now because we have a lot to talk about in this lunchtime chat. And I wanted to share some images with you and a short video. And then we're going to open up to some chat questions. And I'm happy to share a little bit about my work. So today I wanted to talk about Talking Earth. And Talking Earth is the name of my work that my parents started, but I want to go and start with my grandmother. So my grandmother, Eldabun Smith, she is a matriarch. She is a maternal grandmother, and she was a creative person. She became interested in studying shards, and even still in the farmers' fields, they would find shards, they found arrowheads, they would find evidence of our ancestors and ancestors in that area. The Neutrals, and that was a nation that was wiped out, and Tuvalu, that was also a nation that was, my father remembers the last two Tuvalu people who lived behind our property. And so there's this strong connection to land. And so she was looking at shards, and she became fascinated with them and the stories that they held in the land and who made them. And she took it upon herself to study shards and going to museums. And usually in museums, they were alongside other artifacts and bones and in cabinets and cases. And then you could see them reconstructed in archaeological finds, and people talking about our ancestors and the work we did from a very anthropological perspective. And but she was really interested in recreating, remembering, activating. So she began digging her own clay. She became starting to recover what was that process of pottery making, because pottery making had become nobody did it, because we were using functional pots and pans, and it sort of died away. So nobody was using that as an art form or for functional reasons. So she, in the 1960s, revived the lost art of pottery making in our community. And she taught a lot of women and my father and my mother, and had a company called Mohawk Pottery, and became quite active. And that was a part of the 1960s arts revival, arts and crafts. And she was a leading figure in that. She was started one of the, connected with the arts guilds. She was also just this creative. So she was also a leather worker, a seamstress. She had a sewing shop in Brantford, Ontario. She was also collecting antiques, and she became a buyer and seller of antiques. So she was quite interesting. She was also the reason why I became an artist as a young age, as a dancer, because I used to dance for her. She would say that my dancing was her medicine. So I don't remember that, but that's clearly what has motivated me into pursuing the arts. Next slide. And that's her working on a potter's wheel. So that's contemporary form. The next slide would be showing her piece of pottery that she gifted Queen Elizabeth at Expo 68 in Montreal. And I like to show this photo, not simply because this was a gift to the Queen, but because of the intricate designing and etching, which is also called sgraffito technique, on the piece of pottery. And when you get to see it, you'll notice that there are etchings on it that depict wampum belt designs. And those are very interesting, because she was sending this as a visual reminder of our treaty agreements with the crown, with Britain. And that goes back to a lot of our nation to nation agreements. So art is a way to symbolically tell that relationality, visual representation, which is symbolic representation, which was really and continues to be important for Onkwehónwe'néha people. We encoded knowledges, encoded history, not in written writing, not in English or not in the language, but in visual representation. And that is what's really inspiring for me to this day in the work that I do. And knowing that there is encoded knowledge within these designs. So that's what is represented on this piece of pottery. She's got, I see on there, three different wampum belts, friendship belt, the Hiawatha belt, and I'm not sure of that one on the side there. And again, she was offering this as a reminder of this relationship. Next slide. And she went on to teach my father, Steve Smith. This is him, and this is his piece of pottery, which he created and named the studio Talking Earth Pottery, because the title is really important, because it's just very obviously saying the earth is speaking to us, and we are in communication with earth. And so that was really important. Again, the designing and the etching and the contemporary technique that he used was really depicting iconic symbolism. In this piece, you can see herons. Heron is one of the Onkwehónwe'néha clans. Very feminine. There's a woman representing that connection to Mother Earth. Connection to creation story of Sky Woman. And what's really interesting to me and continues to be evident in all of my work are the geometric designs. And the geometric designs from the circle to the spirals to the sun symbols is really embodying and honoring, representing topography, land, landscape, the energy lines, the spiral is a universal energy force. And the ultimate goal for us traditionally through song, dance, video, visual representation, oration, how we planned our community, how we reflected our ceremonial cycle, everything bar none had to do with aligning with nature, to be in sync and in communication. So Talking Earth is a really great name to represent that really important link of speaking to Earth, and the Earth is speaking to us, and we just have to listen. And that's what we have gotten far away from, is that direct communication. And my dad also was world renowned. His vessels became art pieces. They are around the world and gifted to many dignitaries and movie stars. And he and my mom had Talking Earth Pottery as a full-time occupation until 2018, when he was affected with a severe acute case of West Nile virus. And he's not able to continue the pottery. And at that point, I thought I wouldn't be able to continue the pottery, because he was the one who was really making it a day-to-day. He was like, you know, in charge of all the technical aspects of it. And I was there designing. So pottery in that sense became in the back, and my performance had been moving forward anyways. And I thought, well, maybe when I got older, I would come back to pottery. But it was actually more immediate return to pottery when I was selected as the Gardiner Museum's Public Art Commission for Toronto Public Art Art XTO in 2022, last year. Next slide. I wanted to show this one because this was a piece of pottery I designed when I was maybe about 5 years old. So the piece was formed by my dad. And here you can see my rudimentary wampum belt designs. That's a friendship belt. And they're all smiley faces because they're in friendship. And that's important to be, you know, extending love, compassion, unity. That's another strong feature of our philosophy, is to be in unity. And this friendship belt represents unity with the hands clasped together. And then at the top, you see the peaks and valleys of what would have been more of our traditional ancestral territory, Upper State New York, where we have a lot of rolling hills. We have the foothills of the Adirondack Mountains. And we were depicting what we saw. We were depicting the land. And so that comes into my, so from a very early age, I was representing our traditions through visuals. And also this is an working with pottery, if anybody who's worked with clay knows that it's a very embodied process, because it's very tactile. You're breathing on it, you're spitting on the pieces of pottery. It has all of the elements involved, and it's from the land, and you're carving and sculpting it. And it's sort of in a way dictating what's going to manifest. Next slide. And I just wanted to show, this one was a very more contemporary. I don't know when I designed these, that was closer probably to maybe 2016. And it's more refined work. So my father developed a pottery style, which was very difficult, which was throwing wheel on the wheel, fine China porcelain, which is very hard to work with, and created all of the colors, clay slips, and there was a intricate process of layering of clay and etching and carving and painting. So that was very specific, one of a kind. And every single piece that my family has made are one of a kind objects. But again, you get to see the continuation and the repetition of natural pathways, of peaks and valleys, of spirals, of representing nature, of circle symbols. And these butterflies sort of honoring the spirit of the butterfly nation as pollinators. And when I'm working in that way, and it is a intentional, conscious, mindful way of acknowledging. So it's for me, through my embodied practice, through visual arts, these are embodied. So they're not just staying in the intellectual, you know, idea of in a thought process. These are integrated into the body and makes that heart-mind connection that's really important, and which is important in all of our philosophical understandings. Next slide. This takes us to last year. This is the a still image from the activated performance that I called Talking Earth at the Gardner Museum. So the piece of pottery, which is a part of the permanent collection now, is just to the left of the dancer, which is me at the center, and it has some projection on it. And the piece of pottery at the top is a part of the 3D mapping of the building, of the facade of the entrance of the Gardner Museum. And down to the right side is my daughter, who would be the fourth generation recent potter, and she is activated in performance through song, spoken word, and durational building of pottery. And together we have about a 25 minute performance installation that is meditative, that is very visceral, that is energetic, and calling on ancestors, making that ancestral connection to the piece that I call the permanent collection, the ancestor pot. And the one thing that is really prominent in terms of the idea of this piece was fracture. So in this, in the work, we from shards, and I wanted to, I'll show you later when this PowerPoint is off, but we have a lot of shards, and the shards are reminders of these encoded knowledges. So the intactness and the fracture is a theme that comes into a lot of my work, whether it's working on the mashal based on the Mohawk Institute Residential School, or it's working on different productions where we're dealing with colonial disruption and the shattering and the purposeful fracture of our culture is represented. But what is also represented in the in my idea of that is that is we can collect shards, and everybody holds a shard of knowledge. So one person in our community could have a shard of knowledge, and then we're all, I imagine us visually people holding shards of knowledge, and then it's bringing them in proximity to each other, bringing them together. And if anybody knows about pottery, once a pot is broken, fractured, it you can't put it back together. There's no fix to refire. Unless you do something like put it back together with gold, like the Japanese technique, or you basically glue it, but then it's just glued back together. It doesn't connect or form back together again. So that's important. And it also, I also think about the still the shard and the knowledges that are embedded and buried into the earth that we're uncovering through the process of remembering our histories and pre-colonial understandings, that's important work and research that is ongoing for many people, many Indigenous people. Next slide. And here we have, I just wanted to share this as some text words, as sort of a bit of summary of my research, that that this all is, whether I'm doing a performance or designing or strategic planning, or how I program my season and how I design my garden. And really it's looking at embodying the Thanksgiving address, which is to align and respect and take knowledge from nature. So we would call that Indigenous knowledge, science and consciousness. And we will pattern recognition and literacy, and that has to do with understanding the encoded knowledges in the wampum belts, as I mentioned earlier. It also helps us plan stacking of our gardens, what is companion planting. So many of these pre-colonial indigenous knowledges are sort of, you know, being brought to the forefront by things like permaculture and things like that, but, you know, really foundational here on Turtle Island for many years prior. The understanding that we always followed natural law, not man-made laws. And that's really a really important, even in terms of governance and political understanding, that the most important universal natural law is what to follow, because man-made law can be broken, natural law cannot be broken. Man-made law can change and natural law doesn't change. The sun always rises. And that's what we want to be in alignment with. So that's foundational. Form is created through the interaction of energy. So that really goes into my work that I do with land-based creation process, which is inviting the land to shape us so that the energies and the natural pathways that are running around us that we don't necessarily see are shaping us, whether we acknowledge it or not. So it's better to be mindful of it and work with it. And then the reciprocal and regenerative design and planning. So looking at natural pathways and patterns as ways of designing sustainable organic structures that are in alignment with nature, self-sustaining, they are life-sustaining. This includes, I've been doing a lot of planting, my corn, beans, and squash sunflower companion planting. These are old ancient techniques of horticulture that stand the test of time for maximizing your yield and soil cultivation. And that everything is collaborative because everything is interconnected. We are interdependent. So that is a key component of my art practice. And then just, and collaborative means collaborating with nature, collaborating with the land, land as collaborator. And then the idea of being responsive, adaptable, and a sense of readiness. And I can say in my performance of Talking Earth, responsiveness and readiness is a key part of that, because I am in response to the music, in response to what's happening in that moment in a guided improvisational way. And that responsiveness and being activated in the moment. So those are, there's many sort of like ways that all of this knowledge can get, you know, architecture, how we design buildings, how we design our programming of the year and all of that. So lots to think about. Next slide. And here I wanted to give you a little background of the process of making this is towards the final step. So this piece here is the fractured vase. So last year we were creating it, and we were here at inside the McMaster Sculpture Studio, and I worked with Jordi Arfalo, who's also partnered to Carmela Longales, who is the one of the professors in the studio arts, and took us 3.5 straight months to work on these pieces. And so we were posting on social media the process, and you know, we start getting people watching about how it was developing, and you know, showing clips and videos and little moments. And we had 5 test pieces, because you know, if you're making one piece, you for ceramics, you have to make at least 5 or more, because you know, the clay dictates what it wants to do, and we're molding it. So it started to crack, because you know, there were huge pieces, but that was fine with us, because we were intentionally going to crack the pieces. So people were sort of flabbergasted that we were had these beautiful pieces intact, and then slowly they started getting broken. And so there were comments like, oh gosh, I'm so sorry. I mean, that sometimes that happens. Can you do another one? Can you fix it? And I would just be, you know, we were all just so laughing, because we were saying, and I would just say, oh, just wait and see, wait and see. And then they saw us like trying to break it, and like, why would you do that? Why would you do that? Because we had spent so much time meticulously carving the faces, many hours carving and sanding and etching. But that was a part of the process. And that part of the process was to represent this fracturing. And of course, it fractured on its own. One piece, we experimented with breaking it, and it just broke into like 500 pieces. We were like, okay, that's not how to break it. So we came up with a strategy later and tried to break it in the larger pieces. And luckily, we had one that came out, and this is the one. This represents a traditional 4-cornered face pot, which is a part of the style of Onkwehónwe'néha pottery. this is an example of a piece was just working on last summer, and it, so it's like been broken, but it represents the body of a woman. So the base is very much like the womb. It's a container. It holds food, sustenance, water, seeds, afterbirth, you know, corn, everything that was life sustaining could be in there, and herbs, medicine. And this part, we also in pottery terms, it's called the neck. So it represents the neck of the woman. And a lot of times we would put sinew or leather ties around the neck, and we could hold the pot like this at the neck, and then the shoulders and the head, and the head part is open. And we would say that that is open to sky realm. And the traditional pieces of pottery, this one is close, but the actual piece is pointed. So we didn't have tables. We would have had nuzzled and shifted back and forth the point into the earth or into the coals of a fire. And that's how we would have maintained the uprightedness of the piece of pottery. So there's even in the shape, again, talking about form and shape is, symbolic in its it is very feminine, and we're also working with earth, the mother. Next slide. And the process is quite labor intensive, starting from scratch, starting from a block of clay. We didn't dig our own clay, because that would have been a whole other 3-month process. We were on a time schedule to get this piece installed at the Gardner Museum, and building the clay slip. It was a collaboration, because the color in the top right picture is the clay slip that we use to color the piece a nice earth tone. Was my father's batch. So he's very much into that. And I would be, if we ran into trouble, I would be calling home, hey, this happened. What do we do now? And so it became sort of this effort of a lot of people coming and figuring out how we're going to, nobody ever made a, I can't even remember how tall it is, like almost 6 foot tall pot that weighs 330 pounds. So it was an experiment, but a beautiful experiment, because a lot of people came into the care of it and building it. Next slide. And here's what it looks like in the day and the night. So this is sort of looking out of the Gardner Museum, and the ROM is directly across the street. And we've got the four individual unique faces that they're blowing, spirit blowing out, which is very, if you look at traditional Onkwehónwe'en pottery, that a lot of the times the lips were like this, as if speaking or blowing air, breath of life. And so after we made these really heavy shards, we took all the pieces to Hamilton Scenic, and they had to create an internal armature, which was a puzzle, a 3D puzzle, and apparently not an easy one to put together. And my idea was to have to make the cracks prominent, the fracture, and have it lit from the inside. Internal lighting was added. So in the nighttime, if you're going and even going down the street and you look over, you'll see the pot is lit from the inside out. And so the vision became manifest in a great way, and I'm really happy that it did. Unfortunately, you can see the big bolts that were carved into, kind of looks like a Swiss cheese there. We couldn't do it any other way. And we decided not even to try to mask those, because again, it sort of shows that sort of industrial piecing together. It's not pretty, but at the same time, when you see the thing in together, it's beautiful. And that was the big takeaway for me, is that, you know, we're talking about shards and we're talking about fractures and brokenness. And, but really to understand and realize the beauty of that, the beauty of the brokenness and the beauty of the coming together and the beauty of the wish to, or the beauty of slowly approaching each other and hovering and vibrating close to one another. And then what's in the gap, what's in the open spaces. So that is, there's a lot of symbolism again within the overall concept of it. Next slide. And my work with pottery has evolved. And so as a third generation potter, I'm now going almost back to more of a traditional form, which is hand building, outdoor kiln firing, and outdoor firing. And this is our home property at Six Nations. And last summer and this summer, I'll be having a creation lab called Inviting the Land to Shape Us Creation Lab, where artists will come and we will spend a week working with clay. In many ways. So we're building different shapes, but we're also, as in the performance, embodying clay, becoming clay people, because that's all a part of our origin stories as well, of being made and formed of clay. So it's a grounding. It's how we can ground ourselves when our hands and body and feet and hair and eyes and is covered with clay, and you become a clay mud woman. I love it. It's also good for the skin. and then working with Jordi, we built this outdoor kiln, so it's one of a kind as well, and it is it's quite a long process. We were, this piece here, we fired it. We started at 4 in the afternoon. We finished at 7 a.m. in the morning. So it was an all-night process. Next slide. And here's an example of the piece, one of the test pieces that remained intact that we fired and now is at my property. So we didn't put any clay slip on it. So it's just the white raku sculptural clay that we used. But you can see in the corner, there was some cracking, which is also nice, but it remained intact. Next slide. And this is a photo from our recent production called Homelands. And as you can see, pottery and the designing have become so integrated in all of my artistic work. And the three vessels that you see there were, I commissioned my father for a production that we did in 2018, just before he got sick. So I cherish those. They're also integrated into the Talking Earth performance that we'll do tomorrow and on the 21st. And they are precious pieces now, and they become our dramaturgical models of how we work. They become very integrated into designing, into the storytelling, into transformation. They become babies, they become vessels, they become bellies, they become containers. And so next slide. I think that's the end. We have a 3-minute video, and for the video, if we can get it up there, is of Talking Earth from last summer, and it's just little clips, and it's kind of like an archival. So really, to get the magic and the energy and the full scope of it, you have to come to see the show live. Yeah.
Oh, that was wonderful. That's beautiful. We do have a couple of questions that were pre-submitted, but given we just saw that video of the dance, I'm going to go to Melina's question because it is specifically about dance. So she said, you know, you talked earlier about knowledge being encoded in your pottery. Mm-hmm. Is it also encoded in dance in the specific motions, movements?
Absolutely. I study natural pathways, and when we're in creation, most of the time we'll have a land-based part of the creation process, and then we bring that knowledge into the studio, and we, you know, write all of our brainstorming, and we will focus on natural pathways and we'll target, okay, this is elemental earth, this is elemental fire, this is, you know, and so it just sort of gets very much part of the consciousness of how we are building the work. It's integrated into the body memory, because you have, when you're working in the land and then you transpose into a studio, or you transpose into a theater or the steps of the garden or museum, you have to recall what it was like to have your feet in earth. And I have to do that in the performance. I tell the story of getting a big piece of earth and throwing it on the ground and then stepping in it and like working my feet into the, to work the mud, work the clay to build a pot. So that's very visceral. That has to be a visualized, embodied memory to activate.
Oh, really interesting. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's, if you don't mind, Santee, let's go to some of the pre-submitted questions. And then I see some questions coming in through the Q&A. Mm-hmm. This one was an interesting question. You know, is there a traditional prayer you would recommend for use by interested alumni who are working towards peace and reconciliation?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's many Onkwehónwe'néha in every nation. There's so many beautiful understandings out there that you could, you know, there's many. Even I look to quotes of leaders to open my consciousness to, you know, viewing and understanding our relationship with the nature. But for Onkwehónwe'néha people, I would say the key for me is the Ohandu Galawadengwen, which is the Thanksgiving address. And I think that one, and people don't, it's not a prayer. I want to make that clear. Most often these aren't prayers, they're affirmations, they're orations that frame our mindset. So it's not related to religion. It's not a religious. So I actually don't call them prayers. They're just their words. Their affirmations is probably the invocations that are more accurately describe what that is. And people in that sense, is their sense of ownership of it. In fact, the more that people can share this understanding of our interconnectedness, appreciation, acknowledgement, thankfulness, responsibility to every aspect of nature, the better. So there's no, but I guess that would be my go-to one. There's lots of resources online. You can Google what the meanings are in English. So many nations have that on their websites, and that's, you know, again, it's not a prayer. So it's a philosophical framework of viewing the world.
So is it acceptable then for settlers to, since it's not a prayer and it's just sort of an affirmation, are settlers allowed to not use the same affirmations or the same wording, but because it's, we can also acknowledge interconnectedness, is that right? In our own way, like in our,
it's important. Yeah. So especially with work, say if you're working in schools, I think there has to be a fine line between what you're using, which can kind of, if you're not conscious about it, can go into appropriation, or you're doing something that you shouldn't be taking, versus when, or inviting somebody in to share that with you. So for example, and that happens a lot for me with, to share dance or share cultural dance. It's not the same necessarily. I can come in and teach social dancing, but the teacher can't, I wouldn't suggest the teacher then start teaching the social dancing after one offering from me, because it's like, you wouldn't do that in any other form of dance. You wouldn't have one, somebody in the ballet world come and teach a ballet class, and then you become teaching of a ballet class. You know, like there's, there's respect for the form. There's like cultural, ancestral things. So my suggestion is always bring in the people to do that sharing. And then you're there as a catalyst for that, making those connections. But in terms of that, you could also just, you know, print out what the Oneida Nation has on there as like, oh, let's look at this. You know, this is from the Oneida Nation. This is what it's saying. Like, let's reflect on this. So that there's ways of integrating that's not sort of like, I'm going to say these words. So it's basically acknowledging where this important knowledge comes from as well.
Right, is what you would do with anything, right? Like, yeah, if you're writing, yeah, an essay and it's not your idea, yeah, then you acknowledge it, right? You say, yeah, where you've received it from.
Exactly.
So very similar. So we had a number of questions about reconciliation, truth and reconciliation, how we as settlers, you know, can become better allies. You know, what would you recommend, or how would you recommend Canadians, you know, take their first steps towards reconciliation for those who might be unfamiliar or just unsure, you know, mm-hmm, what they can do or what they should be doing? They want to help, but they're not quite sure how. Do you have, mm-hmm, any ideas,
mm-hmm,
that you could share?
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of ideas, and that question comes to me a lot, especially when I'm working on the Mush Hole, which is the performance that we do about the Mohawk Institute Residential School. And so I think we're kind of in an age where there's lots of information out there. So a lot of the times people will have to take their own initiative. So that is like taking the action. I know sometimes there's sort of maybe reluctance because I might do something wrong, or I you know, I don't want to offend anybody. But I think that it's if you're doing things with good intentions and you're doing it, then there's lots of things to do. There's, you know, it can be very simple, or it could be, you know, just bringing awareness But a lot of it is to for every individual to make it an action, make it actionable within themselves, and initiative within themselves to move that forward, because and not always look to Indigenous people for education. So that means self-educate before you go on. There's many resources. Like, I feel like that's not even an option now to say, I don't know, because there's so many things that it's been made aware of what you could do.
So people have to take, like you said, a bit of initiative, right?
Yeah.
It's out there, so yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm just reading a comment. Someone has commented that they were at the convocation last Wednesday. I was there with you as well, working. Congratulations to all the graduates. And she witnessed your Thanksgiving address, and she wanted to say that she just really enjoyed it. She really loved it.
Oh, thank you.
So, and she was glad to hear it again.
I enjoy saying it. So one thing that I people ask me, oh, you're saying it a lot. And I don't feel like you could say it enough, because technically you should be saying that when you wake up in the morning. Like, that is the part of like the sunrise acknowledgement. So it's before every event, before you're gathered. So it's just really fundamental. So for me, it's not, oh, I have to say this thing over and over again. It's always a reminder, and it's an affirmation. It's an affirmation.
And maybe if, people took it as, you know, the sign of gratitude, cause that's what it is. You talk about mm-hmm. the air and the land, mm-hmm. Maybe people would be in a better mood. We seem to be in a really angry state of affairs, right? In the current climate, maybe if people reflected more on the beauty and being grateful for what we have, maybe everyone mm-hmm. would just be in such a better mood.
Grateful. I mean, gratitude is a huge part of our culture, because, it is about that exchange of giving and receiving, call and response. Most of our creative process of singing and dancing is call and response. So you're not doing something in isolation. You know, you're not just this individual. You're in response to lots of things around you. And to know also that you're actually never alone. You're always supported by the nature around. You're never alone.
Well, that's the interconnectedness, right? You are mm-hmm. never alone if you're interconnected.
Mm-hmm.
So Marjorie just asked, are the words to your Thanksgiving address, are they available somewhere?
They are. I know that I sent words, and I think they've got it, but it's also on my Kahawi Dance Theater website page. We have the Thanksgiving address, and we have some other understandings of important themes like Guyana Lake Goa, Gatnagolio, Skana. Those are really important understandings that are on our and Gahawi Dance Theater. You could put that in the chat. GahawiDance.org. And I do think that the university has it somewhere. I just don't have it accessible right now because I have sent it over.
We can also, so everyone will be getting in a couple of days an email with the recording, and I can list in the resources mm-hmm. that as well.
Mm-hmm. And you know, this one is, there's many versions. And so I like to acknowledge, and I know at McMaster, the person that I work with in Six Nations, Dehahande Miller, he is my person that I go to for language, because he's studying Gaingeha, and not just conversational language, but the deeper metaphorical meanings. And so for me, that's my research, is to understand mindset. So, but to say there's many versions. So the long version could last a day, because you're really thinking every, so if it's a tree, you would think every species of tree within your area. If it's the insect, you're naming every insect. So it could go on and on and on and on and on, depending upon what the ceremony is or what the gathering is. So what I offer is basically just like a very rudimentary summary of what the extent of the acknowledgement is.
So if there was a day-long acknowledgement after reciting that for a day, and is there a big feast afterwards? Like, would then, yes, okay.
Yeah, that would be a big event. That right. would be an event where people would be there for a while. Yeah, convocation would be much longer than it is now.
Yes, you'd have the poor graduates and their parents all falling asleep. So Brian is asking an interesting question. You talked about your complementary planting, right? You're a big gardener. Can you speak a bit more about complementary planting?
Mm-hmm. So my understanding and my work that I'm doing now is based on some of our Indigenous horticulture practices, which people would have, you know, turned into what the study of permaculture, but we would have been doing that for years. So we as Onkwehónwe'néha people cultivated many strains of corn, so we understood genetics, so many varieties of corn, so many varieties of sunflower. And so our main companion planting, which is, and there's much more intricateness to this, but the basic one is corn, beans, and squash. And they're planted in a circle mound, with the corn being planted first at the center. And this tall sister, and it's always in relation to the sisterhood of the seeds. And they grow nice and tall and firm, and then you plant at the base you plant the beans, which will vine up, and they will vine up the corn, so they have somewhere to vine. And then outside of that you plant squash in the mound, which does ground cover with the leaves and helps with weeds and then within the soil they provide nutrients to each other, nitrogen, and it gets you the best yield. And then sunflowers were planted on the outsides of the cornfields and the crops, because the birds would go to the sunflowers before they come to your crops. So there was always this understanding of relationality, and I'm sure there's other those are the ones that I can manage myself right now. But that is how they planned their gardening in our communities. The other very interesting, and sustainability, because the other thing about our ancestral community is that we only lived in a place for maybe 5 to 8 years, because we never depleted the resources within where we lived. So our longhouses were structures that were made of wood. They would basically go back to earth. We wouldn't deplete the soil. We would then move into another area to build community and to do our horticulture, agriculture. So that was a fundamental understanding of, hey, you can't use up all the resources. You have to return things to nature. And so we were the ultimate, we had the ultimate sustainability practices. And the understanding that that's something that you don't do.
So with that, given on your land then, do you, since you probably don't then physically move from your house, mm-hmm. so mm-hmm. on your land then, do you use kind of like, I want to say modern agricultural practices, but would you use one area 1 year and then move mm-hmm. to a different plot so that mm-hmm. you are making sure that the soils and the earth is not depleted?
Yeah, I haven't been that long doing it. I'm learning, and every year is learning. But I have two patches, so like two gardens.
And then
we know, like, I have a strawberry patch, which is, you know, not you have to rotate that just naturally. So with next summer, I'll have a new strawberry patch. So some of this is just like general agricultural, but some of it is coming from our traditional understanding of it.
Well, that's wonderful. Maybe I'll bike over and get some of your strawberries, because I always bike, because I live in Ancaster, so I'm always biking, you know, up Binbrook and over. Anyway, we're sort of at the end of our time. We're a few minutes over, and I know this is lunch hour, so people probably need to get back to their, back to work. So I want to thank you, Santee, but I do want to say one thing. Anna Marie sent something in the Q&A, and she just wanted to say that she has one of your pottery that she bought at your house when she met your father, and it was from 2000. And they live in Vancouver, so unfortunately she can't come to the presentation at the Gardner, to your performance this week. But I just thought, what a lovely way to end your talk this evening with a bit of 6 degrees of Santee Smith.
Yay, thank you. And thanks for everybody for tuning in, Nyawe. And if you can come and see our show, you're more than welcome. It's for free. And you just show up outside the Gardner Museum steps, and we go on at 9:30 because we have to wait till the dark gets a little dark. So by the end of the show, the projections are very crisp. So that is coming up. Nyawe, thank you.
Thank you, Santee. Thank you, everyone. We'll see you again soon. Take care. Enjoy your afternoon.